Okay. Hi. Okay. So I'm Drew. I'm from Stripe, but we're building a platform with Temporal, which is a little different than I think what a lot of teams are doing, where they're just building for a single product team. And so I just wanted to talk through like our experience with that and the approach we've been taking. I think it'll be hopefully useful to other folk. I'll just give you some context and I'll talk about how like we give out service, like how teams divide up service ownership for the worker services that we're building on Temporal. I'll talk about our fat client strategy and then some of the protections that we've given our diverse user base against like foot guns. So let's get going. We have a large engineering org and we have three different languages that they use: Ruby, Java, and Go. We want to support all of them. We're building this as a platform for a lot of different teams. From control plane use cases range from control planes to like money movement to like billing subscription management. Just like to frame all of this, if you know anything about Stripe, you probably aren't surprised to know that reliability is like our number one issue. I'm ex-Facebook and I always say that like privacy is to Facebook as reliability is to Stripe. And so we need these workflows that people are writing to be very robust. Okay, so we have distributed ownership of Temporal. So as you might guess, we own the servers. We have two servers. One is for our infrastructure use cases and one for product use cases. But otherwise, the servers will share many use cases. We are relying on Temporal's horizontal scalability and isolation to do this. We did want, however, to isolate infrastructure use cases from any production problems that people might have. Anything a product team might do, we wanted to make sure our control planes could still run independently of that. And then we asked teams to set up a worker, a service to run their workflows per on-call rotation, basically. And for us, given the sort of cost of service ownership at Stripe, we're not a microservices company. We're more of a medium to large services company. And we find that there's a bit of too much overhead for people to adopt the workflow engine if they have to set up a service for every workflow. So we ask them to just own, like have a team or a product area own a workflow. And that ends up being like an on-call rotation that can get paged. And then we try to just lower the cost of service ownership by providing them like dashboards and metrics out of the box. So all the stuff that you'll see, like in the, we like picked some of the metrics from the Cadence operation guide and just implemented some of those and then give them to teams and give pages and other dashboards to them. Okay, we've completely wrapped the Temporal SDK and hid it from our customers. We've done this in both Java and in Ruby. And the reason for this is we are not in a position where we as a team can build up a bunch of institutional knowledge of Temporal and just know to avoid those things. We have a lot of different teams starting to use the workflow engine, and we expect tens to hundreds of teams to ultimately use it. And there's going to be new employees, and even we find ourselves falling victim to versioning issues, even though we're experienced with the framework. For example, like in Ruby, our client adds sorbet types, which is basically, if you don't know what sorbet is, you know, TypeScript is to JavaScript as sorbet is to Ruby as hack is to PHP. So we get static types, yay. By the way, if anybody on the call is using sorbet, we'd love to like connect with you. The focus of our fat client is on productivity and safety. In this talk, I'm just going to talk about some of the safety stuff that we've done. We want to protect our users against classic blunders. We actually have a document called Classic Blunders that aggregates the most commonly seen pitfalls. So the most well-known classic blunder is idempotency of activities, or non-idempotency of activities, I should say. So we think that activities should be opinionated about what the retry policies that are possible with them are. So if you don't know, Temporal will run an activity, it'll attempt once, or it will retry and run it multiple times. And it cannot guarantee exactly once semantics. We force people writing activities to choose which one they are. And the nice thing about this is, in addition to just getting them to think about idempotency, which they don't necessarily do naturally, we can actually call their bluff. And if they mark an activity as execute at least once, then we're going to run it twice in our test framework, compare the results or compare the errors and make sure that they match. This definitely, it's very early. Like we just rolled this out recently, but it's already catching things. So this is something I would recommend if you have the resources to like test for idempotency. Okay. Next, replay safety. So as many of you probably know, workflows, when they execute, they can restart from the beginning and they retrace the history of the execution. And the new execution must match the old. In other words, like the workflow must be pure. It can't have side effects. It can't have randomness. So there's a few ways this can manifest. One is they could be using improperly things like sleep or logging that would happen twice. Also, sleep is using the default sleep is bad because it's going to like hard block, whereas temporal sleep will defer execution, which is what you want. And we use RuboCop in Ruby and error prone in Java to detect statically any calls to like just a fairly long list of functions. This is an example of an error prone check. And then you can see here that we direct them to our classic blunders doc. We're thinking of open sourcing these rules, so please reach out to us if that's something that you'd be interested in Ruby or Java. And we want to see if there would be demand for it. It's not perfect. It can't detect calls inside of functions that are called from workflows, but it still catches a large percentage of these problems. Another thing we do in Ruby is we do network fencing. So we prevent all network calls from within workflows. We're able to do this because we already have an enforcement layer that all network calls go through in our Ruby code base. And basically we just set a thread local, which just says network calls aren't allowed. And we give it a good error message if one uses this. And we do this, we're about to roll this out in production. So we have our fingers crossed. I think it's going to be good. But this is the thing we use to prevent Mongo, Redis access, and so forth. This one's a little trickier to understand, but many of you may be familiar with basic versioning. So if you are adding a field to a gRPC interface, you shouldn't add a required field because clients may not be passing in that field yet. We go a step further and we force people to version their field. So if you're adding a new field, you have to declare a version along with it. And then we use that extra data to just guide more checking at, to make sure people aren't doing bad things. So in Temporal, whenever you add an activity call to an execution, you should put that under a version check. Because if you don't, it's going to be like the replay history, the history replay will change. And Temporal won't be able to tell whether you're just like have some randomness or like impurity in your thing, or you've deployed new code in the middle of a workflow execution. And we found it difficult to tell people about our versioning system. We don't want to force them to use it when they create a workflow, but we want them to find it. And so forcing them to like note, hey, we've got versioning from within, like when they add a new argument, we say you must version this argument. And then if they access the argument and they're still in a version one workflow in this case, we're going to raise an error and say, oh, you've accessed a new field that's only available in version 2 and version 1. And we haven't rolled this out yet, but we think this will prevent them from making a lot of common versioning errors that will then cause them to get non-determinacy errors in production. So that was it. So in summary, we'd love to share what we've done with you, either just like ideas or code. We already are contributing to some of the repos. Just like note down my information and reach out if you want to chat. And as Sean said, we're hiring. So shameless plug for coming to work with us.